Hey everybody, how you doing? Was that it? Lunch was that bad. How's everybody doing?
Awesome!
Just a little bit better. Guys, I am Emma McIlroy. I'm the CEO of Wildfang. Wildfang is the home for tomboys. Wildfang is an online retailer, wildfang.com. If you haven't shopped there yet, shame on you. Wildfang is also a physical retailer. We have a store on Grand where you're all very welcome. We are also a manufacturer. We make our own products. And most importantly, we are a brand. So we are out to create a truly badass lifestyle brand for young women all over the globe. And we are positioned around the tomboy. So think about what Urban Outfitters did for the hipster and the $2 billion business they created there. We're doing the same thing around the tomboy. So it's been a pretty epic first year for Wildfang. We're about 15 months old. What happened in our first year? 22,000 girls signed up in our first month. That was pretty wild, with no paid media. We have been covered in everything from the New York Times to InStyle, from Nylon to Vice, The Guardian to Nothing Major. We've worked with over 50 influencers, Kristen Stewart to Kate Mara, Ellen Page to Evan Rachel Wood, Churches to Chromatics. We've been very blessed in that respect. We have 14 employees, soon to go to 17. I'm actually also recruiting for 3 senior positions, e-commerce, merchant, marketing. If you know anyone, let me know. And we raised just shy of $3 million from some of the best investors in the world. And tiny little secret, last month was our biggest month ever in terms of revenue. Okay, so we're not here to talk about that stuff. We're here to talk about entrepreneurial lessons from the School of Hard Knocks. Despite all those shiny headlines, as a first-time entrepreneur, my partner in crime, Julia, is also a first-time entrepreneur, I can tell you that we most definitely learned our lessons the hard way this year. And so I'm honored to be here. I'm honored to be a part of this event. I love OEN. The opportunity you guys give us is amazing. When I was trying to think about what to tell you guys today, I thought maybe I'll rely on some of the most famous graduates of the School of Hard Knocks, or the most infamous graduates, and that, of course, is rappers, obviously. Obviously, when giving a startup talk, I thought I would rely on gangster rappers. So without further ado, as I move to my first lesson for you guys, first of three, I'm going to call upon the godfathers of hip-hop and rap, which is Run DMC. If we could play that. I did not wrap it. That's the bit. Julia actually said to me as I was leaving, I showed her the presentation before I was leaving, she said, "You're not going to wrap that, right?" So here's lesson number one. You are going to do so much shit that you don't want to do. That's your first lesson. You're going to do so much stuff that feels so not good and is so hard. And most people in life try to avoid that stuff. Most people pick a job where they don't have to do it. And they pick situations in life where they don't have to do it. CEOs don't get that luxury. And I'm not talking about hard times like budgets. You know, 3-year budgets are not my favorite thing to do. Investor reports are not the most enjoyable thing to write up every month. I'm talking about the really hard stuff. So in my first year in business, I have given out bad performance reviews, which sucks. It sits with you all day. You know you're going to do it. Doesn't feel good. I've fired people. I've fired at least one very good friend. I have fired someone who left a very well-paid job somewhere else to come and work at Wildfang, and that was pretty tough. I have disagreed with my senior advisors and investors and made really big decisions that they were in disagreement with. So I'm talking about the things that just bring so much anxiety and stress to your life. They push you to your absolute edge. They push you so far outside of your comfort zone, it's unbelievable. And so what can I tell you guys? What's the advice? It doesn't seem super helpful to say you're going to face some really hard times. I think my first piece of advice is accept it and expect it. You're not a bad person. It's going to happen. I don't know a single other CEO that hasn't had the same experience as us. The second piece of advice is when you face conflict, try to address every situation of conflict with empathy and professionalism. I would say that even the people that I've had situations of conflict with, after time has passed, they are still very good friends and supporters of our business and our family. And that's because of, I think, how Julie and I have handled those situations. The third thing is try to put in place any processes that make things less subjective or less emotional. I'm talking about things like defining your cultural values. Once you define your cultural values, it allows you a filter as to what you should and shouldn't do, who you should and shouldn't hire. Feedback processes, make them very explicit, make time for them. Communicate expectations in a role early and make sure success metrics are clearly communicated. Anything you can do to take that process away from being subjective to objective. The next thing I would say is be kind to yourself. Give yourself a break. Being a CEO is literally the hardest thing you could probably do with your life. And if you don't know how to self-soothe, if you don't know how to give yourself a break occasionally, it's going to be a really rough and rocky path. And the last thing I would say is remember the why. Remember the big mission and make sure you've got a big mission. Everyone on our team knows what our big mission is. And so even in the darkest times, I find that we know that we're doing something for a greater cause and for something outside of ourselves. So yeah, you're gonna meet hard times. Be ready for them. Be ready to find ways to cope with them. But the good news is, there's good news, which is lesson number two, which is there's always a way and there's always a play. Can we play that?
Used to idolize athletes and entertainers because they never let the situation capture them. System gave them lemons, made lemonade, and sold it back to them.
Okay, so what that said is never let the situation capture you. I used to idolize entertainers and athletes because when they were given lemons, they made lemonade and sold it back to them. And I kind of feel like we spend a lot of time doing that in startup. The lesson is it always gets tough, but there is literally always a way and always a play. And the thing that I'm very fortunate to be a part of entrepreneur circles in Portland, also in Vegas, New York, San Francisco. And the thing that I find is a common trend between the most successful startups is even in the most grim and dire situations, they find a way through it, they find a play. If you haven't read Ben Horowitz's book, The Hard Thing About Hard Things, read it. It's one of the best books I've ever read. He talks a lot about this. There are a number of pivotal moments that I could talk about where Wildfang has had its back against the ropes and we've had what felt like no options and no time. I could reference you when we had our private label, our first private label collection arrived 2 weeks before launch in Portland, Maine. Not Portland, Oregon. I could tell you about a very well-known celebrity that I won't name names who decided that she didn't like the photos after all that we'd taken of her and didn't want us to launch our marketing campaign 72 hours before it was due to go live. I could tell you about when we launched our pre-launch campaign and we told everyone that we were going to be live, including The Guardian and New York Times. We were going to be live in 5 weeks, and then our developer went AWOL with a site we've been building for 5.5 months and left us with no code and no front end or back end, and we rebuilt it in 5 weeks. I can guarantee you in startup, people are going to continue to put walls up for you. That is literally the one thing I can guarantee you. The commonality between the best startups is they find a way over, under, around, or through those walls. The relentless belief and refusal to quit starts with one person. That person's a CEO. That's your job. You do not have an option to quit. The belief and positivity must stem from you. You must be the person to motivate your team to find solutions. Like I said, quitting is just not an option for you. So how do you apply this nice big tangential thought? I actually verbalize it. So when the really hard stuff happens at Wildfang, and it happens, I'd say, on a weekly basis, I call the team together and I quite literally say out loud, I verbalize, guys, this is one of those times. This is one of those times when the really bad stuff happened and we always find a way through it. So we're gonna sit here until we find a way through it because that's what we do. And you know what the other thing is? Those are the times when we actually come up with our best stuff. We actually find our moments of genius in those times. So I find that verbalizing it really helps the team and it reinstalls that belief. So lesson number two, there's always a way, there's always a play, and that surfaces when you refuse to take no for an answer. Lesson number three, my last and final lesson for you guys, all the way from the wise philosopher on the East Coast, Gang Starr.
So I'ma get more guys to help me run the whole joint. Cultivate, multiply, motivate, or else we'll die.
Oh, that was heavy, man. Okay, I don't know about the or else we'll die part, but... ooh, were you scratching down there? Okay, he says, we're going to get more guys to help me run the whole joint. We're going to cultivate, multiply, motivate, or else we'll die. Most of you guys are probably in this room because, or many of you, are because you want to be an entrepreneur. You already are an entrepreneur. You've been an entrepreneur before. Entrepreneurs have something in common, which is they're hungry, ambitious, by and large, smart, intelligent, talented, successful. Most people have experienced success in what they've done. Here's the kicker. Your success in startup quite literally does not rely on what you can do. It has nothing to do with what you can do. It has everything to do with what you can get other people to do for you. So lesson number three is the key to your success is in motivating other people. And that's something we absolutely had to learn this year. Every single day, you will be forced to convince other people that what you're doing is right and powerful. That could be vendors, that could be media, that could be staff, that could be investors. But quite literally, the fate of your company no longer rests in your hands alone. And for most entrepreneurs, that's kind of an interesting thing to get their head around. What can you do with that lesson? Some advice that I would offer up for what it's worth. Number one is obsess your team. Know why they turn up to work every day. Know what motivates them. Some of my team are motivated because they're young in their career and they want challenges and mentorship, and we give them access to world-class advisors. Some people are motivated because they had a really cold corporate job before, and Wildfang is probably the most fun place you can work in Portland. Some people are motivated by the fact that they came from a very senior position at a big corporate and didn't have a lot of control. So now they have full control over their function and they have a lot of empowerment. But I would urge you in the motivation of others to work out what keeps your employees high, because when they're high, they move mountains. The second thing I would say to you is become a great salesman and a phenomenal storyteller. You are going to tell stories and sell every single day from now forward. I was in Seattle at another conference yesterday speaking, and I was there for 24 hours, and in that time I managed to convince three baristas and one bartender that they needed to shop at Wildfang. So get real good at it. You're going to become a salesman very quickly. The third thing I would say in the motivation of others is focus on the win for your partner. It's phenomenal to me how many startups turn up and say, can I have, give me this, can you tell me this? In startup, you're going to spend so much time with people who are more important than you, know more than you, and whose time is more precious than yours. And so I try to go into every one of those meetings, whether it's a celebrity or an investor, and the first thing I try to do is create a win for them. Why should they care about my company? What can I do for them? And what's the win for them? And I find that when you go into any discussion with that approach and you create a win for somebody else before trying to create a win for yourself, the discussion goes much better. Lesson three, the motivation of others is going to be the key to your success. So if you're going to practice anything, practice coaching and selling. Those are my three lessons for you guys today. Number one, you're going to do a lot of stuff you don't want to do. Be prepared for it. Learn how to cope with it. Number two, there is quite literally always a way and always a play, and the best startups are the ones that refuse to take no for an answer. And the third thing I would say is the motivation of others is going to be the key to your success. So before I get off the stage, I will use this opportunity to relentlessly plug Wildfang. If you have not shopped there before, you really should. And as a tiny little gesture of our thanks for being here, if you go to our website and place an order anytime between now and midnight on Sunday, and you input the code OEN, thanks to our amazing partners, you'll get 15% off your order. So you quite literally have no excuse. Thank you.